Day observance. So we're here today to honor and support the amazing resilience of young adults, even in the face of life's most difficult challenges. Young adults like this year's honorary chairperson, Kiara de Blasio, who has offered hope to millions of her peers by having the courage to speak publicly about her experiences with depression and substance use. It's a particular privilege for me to have New York City's first family with us. New York City, born and raised, I'm a product of public housing and public education through graduate school. And now my grandchildren live and attend school just a block or two away from the de Blasio home in Brooklyn. But what Mayor de Blasio and his family represent for those of us who live and vote in New York is the opportunity for all children to have what I had, support from the public system. This afternoon, though, we are one community and one family as we join a candid conversation with four young adults at 4 p.m. Their presentation is called What Really Works for Young Adults, and I know they won't mince words in helping us learn how to help. I'm pleased to turn this program over to a very skilled man. It's Master of Ceremonies, WJLA-TV, ABC 7 news anchor, Leon Harris.
Linda, thank you. Hello, everyone. If you're visiting from out of town, I sure hope that we've produced enough pollen to give you the true Washington springtime experience here. It is a pleasure to be here once again hosting SAMHSA's National Children's Mental Health Awareness Day. Today, I'm looking forward to introducing you and to learning from some really strong, resilient young adults who've experienced a lot of bumps in the road in their lives as they've transitioned from childhood to adult responsibilities. We talk with them, along with others across the country, about their experiences growing up with behavioral health problems, and not surprisingly, they told us that their biggest challenges during the transition to adulthood were related to finding a place to live, getting an education, finding a job. Well, you might find it interesting that these young adults didn't immediately identify mental health and substance abuse services as a priority. In fact, the key to successfully addressing these problems with young adults is to develop and build trust. And by engaging the help of their friends, mentors, landlords, teachers, family, people in their environment, you'll be hearing a lot more about the success of this peer support approach this afternoon. And to tell us more about the behavioral health needs of these young adults, please join me in welcoming SAMHSA Administrator Pamela Hyde.
Thanks so much, Leon, and good afternoon, everyone. And thank you for being here to help us launch National Children's Mental Health Awareness Day. I'm especially grateful to Linda Rosenberg and the National Council for serving as our generous hosts, and for Health and Human Services Secretary Kathleen Sebelius, a remarkable leader and a passionate advocate for behavioral health and countless other issues that impact the health and well-being of children and young people. Over the past 9 years, Awareness Day has evolved into a national platform to recognize the importance of mental health and recovery for children, youth, and young adults, and to build awareness around substance abuse prevention. More than 140 federal programs and national organizations are joining over 1,100 communities across the country to observe Awareness Day this year. And yet, mental health is one of the perhaps least understood public health issues that we face as a country. Suicide steals loved ones. Untreated depression denies joy and simple pleasures to millions. And substance abuse dims the bright light of countless futures. Co-occurring disorders, meaning having both a mental health and a substance use disorder, are prominent in the juvenile and criminal justice systems. Today, as part of our launch event, SAMHSA is releasing a new report titled Serious Mental Health Challenges Among Older Adolescents and Young Adults. The data in this report tell us that one in five almost 6.5 million young adults, ages 18 to 25, had a mental illness in the past year. And nearly a quarter of them say that mental illness has substantially interfered with their ability to function in one or more major life activities. About 2.2 million young adults are dealing with co-occurring mental illness and substance use disorders. And 1 in 10, 16 to 17-year-olds, had a major depressive episode in the last year. Unfortunately, we also know that young adults are less likely to access mental health services as compared to adults over age 26. And in fact, about two-thirds of young adults with mental illness did not receive any mental health services in the past year, and 43% with co-occurring disorders did not receive treatment. This is not just unfortunate, it's unacceptable. Because we know that when these young people receive evidence-based treatment and services, they get better. These services and supports work, and we need to ensure that every older adolescent and young adult can access help when they need it. This afternoon, you're going to meet some individuals who will talk about their challenges in education, employment, housing, and juvenile justice related to behavioral health issues. They're going to describe the kinds of services and supports that have helped them and many others stay on a path to that bright future that everyone dreams of and that we want for all of them. We're also going to learn more about how young adults are helping each other through these major life challenges and show you some examples of how that can work, whether the support comes from professionals, friends, mentors, coworkers, or family. In fact, family support is how our 2014 honorary chair, Chiara de Blasio, says she got through a difficult period of young adulthood.
Every kid who grows up in New York grows up pretty fast. It's astonishing. I've had depression, like clinical depression, for like my entire adolescence. And so that's been something that I've always dealt with, or not known how to deal with. It made it easier, like, the more I drank and did drugs, to share some common ground with people that I wouldn't have. When I went away to college, I didn't really do the proper mental and emotional work to prepare myself. I kind of just thought that all my problems would go away. My therapist, who I'm so grateful for, she did me the biggest service ever. She referred me to a outpatient treatment center in New York City. My mom was trying really hard to help me, just like, you know, any little thing she could. I mean, my dad was doing the same, but obviously he was really busy. But, you know, they were both very emotionally committed to trying to figure out some way to get me better. Removing substances from my life, it's opened so many doors for me. Like, I was actually able to participate in my dad's campaign, and that was like the greatest thing ever. And, you know, now I'm doing well in school, finding people that have gone through it, being honest, open, and willing. And you will see the most immense change that you've ever seen before.
To introduce this extraordinary young woman, please welcome her parents, New York City Mayor Bill de Blasio and New York City First Lady Shirlane McCray. Spiked out, I could trip a referee. Tell by my attitude that I'm most definitely
thank you, Administrator Hyde. This is a very special day for our family. Last summer, when Chiara opened up about how much she was suffering, I started researching. Whatever she needed, I was going to get it for her. But as she began her recovery, I realized Kiara didn't need me or her father to take charge of her life. She needed us to walk beside her and listen. So many young people who are struggling with this disease slip into self-destructive spirals that can last for years or even lifetimes. Kiara had that self-resolve to jump straight into the hard work of recovery. She somehow found the strength to help herself and also to help others. She is a remarkable young woman. I'm not just proud of her, I'm in awe. And her father, Bill de Blasio, the mayor of New York City, is not going to let me have the last word about this.
First Lady is right as usual. I want to thank Secretary Sebelius and Administrator Hyde and Linda Rosenberg and all of the organizations that are here today for such an important gathering. And for me, I have the honor of introducing the honorary chair of this event. Now, typically, I have had the opportunity to introduce honorary chairs. Most of the time, they're a lot older than me. And I'm used to expressing their many, many years and decades of service, but this is a new situation for me today, to have an honorary chair who happens to be my 19-year-old daughter. And I couldn't be prouder, because she stood up, she spoke from the heart, she worked so hard at sobriety. And for her, it's something that means so much. She talks about it with us all the time. She marks every one-month anniversary with pride. And it's something especially powerful to me because in my own life, in my own family, we faced these demons before. My own father was an alcoholic. He could not, unfortunately, tragically, find his way to this kind of help, this kind of recovery. But his granddaughter could, and she did. And there's something powerful in that. So we know that we all have to speak up. We all have to recognize what so many of us are facing, what so many families are facing, what it's doing to our society. We need people to speak up. We need people to be a positive example. And that is what Kiara chose to do. She chose to speak out because she wanted to help others. So many people have told me they were moved by her story. They learned from it. It helped them have a conversation in their family they needed to have. And for Shalane and I, that makes us so proud of Kiara and what she is already doing to help others. And with that, it is my honor to present the 2014 Honorary Chair for National Children's Mental Health Awareness Day, Kiara de Blasio.
I wonder what would happen if you say what you want to say. The words fall out. Honestly, I want to stay up at night. What you want to say.
Thank you, Mom and Dad. I couldn't have been so successful in my recovery if not for your love and support. I want to say a big thank you to everyone at SAMHSA for naming me the Honorary Chairperson of Awareness Day. Many congratulations to the other young adults. Thank you for all of your amazing work, and thank you for your commitment to the cause. I am so honored to be recognized, and frankly, I still haven't processed how excited I am, but I certainly am grateful. And I would like you to know that this is only the beginning of what I hope to be a lifelong career of helping others affected by mental illness. Thank you.
Thank you, Kiara. Thank you, and thank you for putting yourself out here on the line to help make a difference for others. And you will make a difference for others. Now, Kiara is the first of five impressive young adults that you're going to meet this afternoon. The next is Quayle Peltier. Now, Quayle knows the importance of a supportive education environment after having to live with the experience of being bullied in high school. in Quail's view, and with most of you probably here agreeing with us, educational settings like schools and university campuses, well, they need to be places of inclusion, places where differences are recognized and embraced. The report that Administrator Hyde referenced earlier confirms that older adolescents who have behavioral health problems are struggling in school. In fact, nearly 14% of adolescents who had a major depressive episode or a substance use disorder and were enrolled in school had a grade average of D or lower. However, we know that young adults who get treatment are more likely to go on and graduate from high school than their peers with a mental illness who don't receive treatment. Now, let's learn a little bit more about Quail's experience.
It was really difficult for me, particularly in school, because I am a visibly queer person. I live in a very rural area. The first high school I attended was McKinleyville High School. There was a lot of hostility, but, I mean, it was really difficult in high school to be engaged because I didn't feel safe on campus, so oftentimes I wouldn't go to class. The harassment and bullying that I received, like, I was very, very depressed. So what I did during that time was, you know, read books, self-harm, whether it was cutting or bulimia or alcohol, those kind of things. I didn't really, like, during that time of my life when I started high school, I really didn't have any friends. For me, having other young queer people that were open about experiencing issues with their mental health made me feel severely less lonely. Through being involved in ECTC, I met people that have made, like, such a huge difference in my life.
Ladies and gentlemen, would you please welcome Quail Peltier.
Together we stand, I'll be by your side, you know I'll take your hand. When it gets cold and it feels like the end, there's no place to go, you know.
Good afternoon. As you just saw, life wasn't easy for me in school. And I'm in Washington today so that I might help others have a more positive educational experience and a voice in system transformation. In my rural community, there was a lack of safe, accessible, and competent mental health services for gender and sexual minority students and people. Schools need to have enough behavioral health staff to meet the needs of all students, because school is a natural place where youth receive support. Bullying exists. Oh, thank you. Bullying exists in schools, playgrounds, on social media. And it occurs to me now that the school system did not know how to handle it. That is why it's important for schools to use positive school climate models that address policy, training, and student engagement. In college, thank you. In college, I found support from queer youth making a difference in my community. I wish I had had that kind of support in high school. Providers and educators, you can encourage schools to develop gay straight alliances or other peer support networks in middle school and high schools. If I had had that support and was empowered early on, my experience in education would have been safe and provided me with the tools I needed to navigate my life. I call on those of you in leadership positions to include well-supported and authentic youth voice in every possible decision that involves the services that youth receive. Please remember, nothing about us without us. Thank you for having me here today.
When it gets cold and it feels like the end, there's no place to go, you know I won't give in.
Yes, that deserved a standing ovation. Thank you, Quayle. One of the critical elements to recovery from mental health and substance use problems is meaningful, reliable employment. Now, whether a person is pursuing a lifelong career or simply trying to pay their bills and live from day to day, employment offers both an opportunity and a challenge. But it's not an easy path if you have a mental illness. Nearly 20% of young adults who have a co-occurring mental illness and substance use disorder are unemployed. Young adults with mental health needs are often unsure about how to obtain and keep a job, especially if they're trying to balance their personal health challenges with the expectations of their employers. Some people, people like Sean Campbell, they go on to find unique arrangements that fit with their behavioral health needs. Sean successfully turned his peer support experience into a career path. Take a look.
Like all of us in some way, I became a peer support leader because I had faced my own experiences with mental health challenges, both personally and in my family, and I felt compelled to go outward and begin to share my story. And so I decided, how best could I do this? And I was able to market myself as an individual who could go out to universities and high schools and different programs in the community and share my experiences and share my story. I am working with a county currently to implement SAMHSA's 8 Dimensions of Wellness, to implement a whole body wellness initiative throughout the county. What I've been able to do is find young individuals like myself in their 20s and also older mentors who are entrepreneurs and understand the process and understand the fears and anxieties and uncertainties. And through our shared experiences, we're able to help each other out and navigate challenges that we face.
Ladies and gentlemen, would you please join me in welcoming Sean Campbell.
The best, you can be the King Kong banging on your chest. You can beat the world, you can beat the war. You can talk the guy, go banging on your...
Hello, my name is Sean Campbell, and I believe that employment is a significant challenge for today's emerging adults. And young adults with behavioral health needs are no different. Securing productive, meaningful work, in my opinion, is as important as any other aspect of wellness. But we can't do it alone, which is why it's so important to integrate employment services and supports into treatment and recovery. Thank you. From my experience, there are 3 stages in which we can help young adults maintain work. The first is preparation. Providers, peers, and adult allies can help a young person understand what is expected in the workforce, consider a career path that best suits them, stay motivated if there is a long job search process, and navigate the anxiety of interviews. The second is thriving in a job. Young adults may need support in successfully performing their job requirements, especially if they're feeling stressed, depressed, or anxious. They may need logistical supports, which can be obtaining transportation to and from work, for example, or interpersonal supports to foster effective communication with coworkers, supervisors, and partners. And finally, is preparing for the future. I did not become an entrepreneur on my own. I had friends and peers helping me visualize what I wanted to do and exactly how I could do it. And I'm very proud of the success that I have had thus far. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sean. I want to ask everyone here to think about one simple little thing for a quick second. Think about your address. All right? That little piece of information is a key to a lot of other services in our lives. You know, not having a stable home environment as a young adult makes it that much harder to succeed in every other area of your life. It can impede securing employment, getting access to regular health care services, or even medical records, or completing college applications, more. The data released today shows that young adults with mental illnesses are nearly twice as likely to have moved two or three more times in the past year or so. And that much uncertainty can isolate young adults from their friends and families, leaving them with no real place to call home. Michelle Vance knows firsthand the importance of finding stable housing. Let's learn now a little more about her.
When I was a teenager, I was homeless for about 6 months. And kind of during that time, I didn't know where I was going to sleep. I slept in my car sometimes. Sometimes I would find a friend and I'd be able to crash at their house. But that really impacted my life, you know, just being worried about my safety, you know, if I was going to live or not, you know, where I was going to eat. After, you know, experiencing that and kind of hopping from couch to couch, I was able to meet someone who turned into be one of my greatest mentors. She helped me figure out some of the health problems that I was having. I was really sick and I wasn't able to work. She helped me figure out a stable place to stay, and it was a safe place to stay. Peer support is kind of a new thing in Utah, and so when they brought her out in the training, it was a new opportunity to learn. Even if you don't know somebody's whole story, how you can still respect them and how you can use your own experiences to maybe help them avoid some of the hard things that you've experienced, or just the things that you can learn from another person.
Ladies and gentlemen, would you please join me in welcoming Michelle Vance.
Oh, hey guys. I'm Michelle. When I was 19, I was homeless for a little while. When I was homeless, I became physically unwell. I rarely got a full night's rest. I was always stressed out and tired. My eyes looked sunken in, and I lost a lot of weight. I had a lot of trouble concentrating as well. Because of this, people would ask me if I was using drugs. I'm not saying this doesn't happen, but using substances wasn't my experience at that time. I think it would have been a lot more helpful for me if someone had asked whether I'd eaten last night, or whether I'd slept, if I slept at all. Every night I had to figure out where I was going to spend the night. There are strings attached when you crash on somebody's couch when you don't have one. Sometimes staying over means something must be given in return. I was constantly negotiating the terms of staying with someone. I had to bend some of my values and my own beliefs in order to stay safe. Caseworkers have recommended to me and to others in order to secure stable housing that we should move in with our boyfriends or girlfriends. Don't do this. Don't do this. What happens when that relationship ends? We're back to square one. I've learned through my experiences that the only person who will change my life is myself. But the support of peers who expect and wish the best for me is incredibly helpful. Thank you for having me here today.
Well, thank you, Michelle. Next, we welcome the Executive Director of the National Association for State Alcohol Drug Abuse Directors, Mr. Rob Morrison, and his very special guest, his son, Robert. Gentlemen.
Thank you, and thank you to Samson and Pam Hyde, the National Council, and Linda Rosenberg, and the youth here today. And to think we gave him a stage. I'm not here as an executive director. I'm here as a family member, joined by my wife, Meg, my daughter, Carrie, my sister, Bronwyn, and they're here in the audience and on stage here with my son. His name's Robert. See, Robert's had some challenges with anxiety, but despite these challenges, he doesn't let it slow him down, not one bit. We get through it all as a team. Just like Secretary Clinton once observed, it takes a village, and I certainly agree. But instead of me talking, I'd like to introduce you to my son. His name's Robert Morrison. Robert.
Thanks. Before getting help, I had a hard time controlling how much I worried and what I was worried about. But now with the help of my family and my doctor, I have way more good days than bad days. Things can still be hard, but I know I have the tools to get through the tough times. Now it seems like I'm more worried about being a good catcher for my baseball team or making sure my Boston Red Sox win their next game. Thank you for allowing me to be here. Now I invite you to meet Mr. Jim St. Germain.
Between the ages of 16 and 25, I faced numerous obstacles. When I was 16, I was actually in the juvenile justice system. Basically, you know, I wasn't home and I was away, incarcerated. When I was in the streets, misbehaving and doing certain things and being involved in gang activities and, you know, drugs and alcohol, I was also living in this place, which was like an empty apartment in an abandoned house. And, you know, as a young man, having to deal with those experiences really kind of break me down mentally. Peer support is one of the things that's responsible for all the success I've achieved in the past few years. It was critical having someone sort of like around the same age group as me to help me understand that I wasn't going through some of my challenges and obstacles by myself. That, you know, there are other people out there who are dealing with the same circumstances and they're willing to lend me their support and help me trying to figure things out.
Please join me in welcoming Jim to the stage.
Never let go of me. Yeah. Hold tight, it's gonna get hard to breathe.
Hold tight, baby.
Never, never to let you down, even if we go
with. Thank you, Robert. Robert was awesome. He's such a great speaker. Actually, in the back, I was telling him that I want him to be my coach, so. But the only problem we got is that he's a Red Sox fan. I'm a Yankee fan, so. We're going to have to work that out. Good afternoon, everyone, and I want to thank you guys for being here. It's an honor, and I truly appreciate your presence. I'm pretty sure that there's so many other things you can be doing at the moment, but yet you chose to be here for a really good cause, and I'm really thankful for that. As you heard, I'm a young man who's dealt with a lot of hardships and challenges growing up. I'm from Brooklyn, New York. And growing up in an urban environment is not the easiest thing. You know, I've struggled a lot growing up. I've dealt with a lot of difficult issues such as gangs and drugs and losing a lot of friends to gun violence. From the age of 14 to now, I've lost over 16 friends to gun violence. And a lot of them were murdered in broad daylight in the streets, and some I actually had to witness. At the age of 14, I was arrested and placed in the juvenile justice system, where I stayed for about 3.5 years. And in the juvenile justice system is where I really found some of the help and other adults who were supportive and willing to try to fight for me. So I was really thankful to those individuals for all their help and their support. When I left the juvenile justice system, I was able to finish my GED and go to college, where I receive a bachelor's degree in political science. Thank you. Thank you very much. Since then, I was able to go back to the same facility that I was incarcerated in as a young man and work there with the young people who are currently incarcerated in there. So it was a really amazing experience for me being there as a staff in the same facility that just a few years ago I was actually locked up in. I've been able to accomplish a lot of amazing things, including working with so many different policymakers and stakeholders regarding juvenile justice issues. But my success is really irrelevant if us as a nation, as a society, is not investing in our young people and helping them to do better. So today it's really not about me. I'm here speaking on behalf of thousands of young people who are dealing with a lot of challenges and hardships, single parents' households, poverty, subpar schools, violence, and so many other things that a lot of you are familiar with, and they need your help. They need us as stakeholders, local government, state government, federal government, to invest in them so later on in life they don't become burdens, tax burdens. Instead, they could become productive members of society, work and pay taxes, and end up running this nation and helping other young men and women. So I know that just a few miles away from here in Capitol Hill, most people's three favorite words are smart economic policies. I know that we really love these three words. So I'm here to tell you that if we don't invest in our young people who are going through hardships, who are facing so many difficulties, right, if we don't invest in them now, then eventually later on we'll end up paying a lot more while incarcerating them, and we can't get nothing back for it. So last but not least, I've recently been accepted to NYU, where I will be pursuing a master's in public administration and managerial non-for-profit. But once again, I need you guys to stay focused on our young people and keep helping them and keep providing more services and the help that they need, so later on we can have more success stories like myself. Thank you very much and have a blessed day. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Hey, Jim. Thanks, boy, man. Absolutely awesome. I gotta say, this is off the record. Nah, this is on the record. God, I wish I could have a young man like that in every one of my newscasts. Keep it up, Jim. Clearly, navigating and recovering from an experience in the juvenile justice system is incredibly daunting for young adults. And unfortunately, young adults with a mental illness or substance use disorder are three times more likely to have been on probation or parole in the past year compared to their peers when you look at the numbers. And that is why we are so pleased to have an expert on hand with us this afternoon to tell us about how to turn that around. Would you please welcome the administrator for the Office of Juvenile Justice and Delinquency Prevention, Mr. Bob Listenby.
Thank you so much, Leon, and thanks to SAMHSA for inviting me to speak today. Jim just spoke about how the justice system can help older adolescents as they transition into adulthood. At the Office of Juvenile Justice and Delinquency Prevention, we fund several programs and initiatives that support increased collaboration between mental health and juvenile justice systems. We know how important it is to protect youth who may be vulnerable and what the consequences are for not offering that protection. In the study our office supports, called the Northwestern Juvenile Project, we found that 84% of youth in detention have experienced at least one traumatic event, and more than 56% have been exposed to traumatic events six or more times. Exposure to trauma has a ripple effect. Young people exposed to trauma are more likely to abuse drugs and alcohol, suffer from serious medical problems, and suffer from depression, anxiety, and post-traumatic stress disorders. It's no surprise, then, that they also are more likely to fail in school and in the workplace and engage in delinquent and criminal behavior. These are unacceptable outcomes, and the Office of Juvenile Justice and Delinquency Prevention is joining Jim's call and that of all young people for our juvenile justice system to be more responsive to the developmental needs of our children and youth. Young people are not adults. Young people are not adults. Our office commissioned the National Academy of Sciences to study juvenile justice in light of current knowledge about adolescent development. Science says that the brain of young people is wired differently from that of adults. Neurobiological processes play a large role in adolescent impulsiveness, susceptibility to peer pressure, and difficulty in seeing long-term consequences of their actions. While that may mean that adolescent behavior may get them into trouble more easily, it also means that they can more easily change because their brains are still developing. The harsh, punitive practices too often found in the juvenile justice system don't meet the developmental needs of youth in their care at all. What we do know is that we've been talking about here today, involvement of a supportive adult authority figure, association with peers who can help, and activities that encourage autonomous decision-making improve lives. The Department of Justice is collaborating with SAMHSA grant programs to support the systems of care model through an interagency agreement to provide training and technical assistance for young adults with or at risk of involvement in the juvenile justice system. Everyone, at some point in their life, needs a helping hand and the opportunity to succeed. As we offer young adults the support they need in education, in housing, in employment, and in access to health care, I challenge all of us to ensure that the juvenile justice system serves them in a way that is appropriate for their level of development and that gives them the support they need to lead healthy, productive lives. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Bob. The experiences of young adults with behavioral health challenges, while unique to each of them, and you have heard some incredible stories today, mirror the problems of other young adults. But not everyone has found the support they need to get through these challenges. That's where we have to do better. And we have allies in this pursuit. It gives me great pleasure to tell you about Kathleen Sebelius. She's been a leader on challenging health issues for the past 6 years, serving as our country's Secretary of Health and Human Services. She understands that our nation's young people struggle to achieve their potential in an increasingly complicated world. And she's worked every day in her position to ensure that they and their families are not on that journey alone. Please welcome the Secretary of Health and Human Services, Kathleen Sebelius.
Thank you very much. It's my real delight to be with all of you today, and I want to start by thanking and recognizing Pam Hyde. She deserves a huge applause. Pam does so much as the leader for our incredibly important agency, the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration. She's a great leader, she's a great partner to the state and local level, and she really gets these issues in a way that is so important to millions of people across this country. I also want to say I'm delighted to be joined today by the de Blasio family, and while you're going to see one of their superstars up here, I want to recognize the mayor again and his wife who are with us today, the mayor and the First Lady of New York. Could you give them another round of applause, please? Now, there's a great story about former President Lyndon Johnson. Supposedly, one day when things got particularly tough at the White House, he turned to an aide and said, you know, things are bad. I mean, they are really bad. But they could be worse. I could be a big city mayor. And I must say, as things were up and down during some of our recent period, I thought to myself, well, at least I'm not the mayor of New York City. But I'm so glad Mayor de Blasio is the mayor of New York City. He's a terrific leader. Yes, you can give him another round of applause. You know, we had the chance to work recently on an issue that's going to be huge for New York, and that's the expansion of the state's Medicaid waiver. And it really shows how innovation and new thinking, a way to deliver new care and to really focus on services that are so important to the people of his city, we can all work together to improve the quality of care we deliver to fellow citizens. You know, I was the governor of Kansas in one of my former lives, and there's some Kansas folks here. I am out also, yeah, we can talk about that later. I'm also the daughter of a former governor of Ohio, the only father-daughter team in history, and I just shared with Kiara backstage that I think that generation should repeat itself. We need some more father-daughter teams in history. So you can make your own decision when she comes up here, but I want to keep that to keep in mind. Now, you're going to hear from Kiara de Blasio in a few minutes, but as we recognize her courage and leadership, I want to just spend a few minutes talking about why her voice is so important. Here's what we know. That 3/4 of adult mental health conditions appear before the age of 24. But we still have way too many adults who fail to recognize the signs of mental stress, mental illness, or addiction in young people. And way too many of our younger Americans don't feel safe enough to ask for help. It takes a lot of courage to seek help. Not just go and get help in the first place, but to speak up about it so that other people then can have the courage to get help themselves. We need to move beyond the idea in this country that when we talk about mental health conditions or addiction, we're talking about somebody else. It's not somebody else. It's all of us. It's all of our families. It's all of our neighbors. It's all of our kids. We need to get to a place in this country where everybody feels comfortable accessing treatment without the fear of getting judged, to a place where anyone feels as comfortable saying they're going for counseling as they are saying they're going for a flu shot or getting physical therapy. And that's why, at the President's request, Education Secretary Arne Duncan and I launched a national dialogue on mental health. And Americans are joining this dialogue across the country, coming forward to identify gaps in services in their own communities, bringing issues out of the shadow and talking about the fact that treatment is available. Now, when it comes to young people especially, we know that recovery from behavioral health and substance use challenges is attainable with the proper support. The deal that we ought to be able to make with any young person is that if you have the courage to ask for help, we'll make sure that help is accessible to you. Now, we're in the midst of the largest expansion of mental health and substance use services in decades. The combination, and yes, that is a very good deal. What we've got going on right now is the combination of the long overdue parity rule to make sure that mental health issues are treated the same way as physical health issues, and the Affordable Care Act expanding, finally, coverage to millions of uninsured and underinsured Americans. The result of that partnership will mean that more than 60 million Americans will have access to substance use and mental health treatment that didn't have it before. And that's a huge step forward. As a result of that, fewer of our younger people will risk aging out of services. They can now access them throughout their lifetimes. Because of the Affordable Care Act, your insurance company has to offer preventive services, including screenings for alcohol abuse and depression, and behavioral assessments for children, all without copays or out-of-pocket fees. Neither young people or their parents can ever be denied coverage again because of a pre-existing condition, and that is a huge step forward in this country. And it's becoming more affordable than ever to get covered in the first place. Young people can stay on their parents' plans until the age of 26, and millions of Americans, and hopefully millions more as we continue this effort, will get covered under Medicaid. States are moving forward with expansion. We now have more than half the country, and we need to turn up the Bunsen burner under those states that have not yet taken up that plan. It's a critical battle. And we have more than 8 million Americans who have signed up for health insurance through the marketplaces. Now, that kind of open enrollment is a testament to the affordability and accessibility of private marketplace coverage that now comes with mental health and substance use services. So in addition to expanding access to services, we've been investing to make sure that services are widely available to patients in their own communities. Through the Now is the Time initiative, we've invested millions to train more mental health professionals, and the President's 2015 budget includes even more significant investments. We're helping with programs that help teachers identify conditions their students may have, along with resources and toolkits available to them. But unfortunately, even with those kinds of investments and even with expanded insurance coverage, in order to access services, young people need to feel comfortable coming forward. And once they do, they often find out they're absolutely not alone. They find that members of their families, their churches, their synagogues and schools, their neighborhoods come forward as well. And with that in mind and knowing how powerful these young voices are, I want to bring up Chiara de Blasio and present her with our special recognition award for her resilience, for her courage in speaking out about her own experiences, and for being an inspiring, hopeful voice for young adults. Chiara, would you come forward?
Sometimes a shadow wins. I wonder what would happen if you say what you want to say. Look at the words fall out. Honestly,
thank you so much, Secretary Sebelius, for this award, as well as for your service to the people of this country. Can we give her another round of applause? This award is truly an honor and a blessing. But the truth is, no award or achievement will mark the end of my personal battles with addiction and mental illness, nor will I ever stop fighting to make recovery possible for others. But today, I am grateful and overjoyed. 1 year ago, I could not have imagined that I would be standing before you today as a sober and healthy young woman. One year ago, I was lost, confused, and overpowered by depression, anxiety, addiction, and fear. 1 year ago, life didn't seem worthwhile. 1 year later, here I am, and that is nothing other than a miracle. Now, for the rest of these brief remarks, I could talk about myself, but I won't, because if not for other people, I wouldn't have made it to where I am today. So thank you, Dad. Even while running the biggest city in America, you still give me more love and support than I could ask for. And thank you, Mom, for your patience and your endless dedication to helping me get better. Thank you, Dante. You're the best little brother in the world, and this is the only time you will catch me saying so. thank you to mental health professionals everywhere. You have helped me and others to see that life is worth living. Thank you to the treatment centers. You lay the foundations for beautiful lives. Thank you to every single person in recovery. No matter who you are, no matter how long you've been in recovery, be it one day or 20 years, you are carrying the message that we don't have to live like that anymore. I am blessed to be able to carry the message today. In the spirit of recovery, I aspire to give to others the gift that was so freely given to me. And I hope you hear me loud and clear. The battle against mental illness is not easy, nor is it painless, but it is worth it. Please listen to the people in your life, especially those who are struggling. If you are suffering, there is a way out. I ask you to please talk to a mental health professional or someone else you trust. We never have to fight this battle alone. Thank you again, SAMHSA. And thank you to the people that got me here. Thank you for giving me my life back.
Isn't she great? We need voices like that. Thank you so much, Kiara, and all the young adults who have generously shared their stories and ideas with us today. We have a real challenge before us to better meet the behavioral health needs of these and all the young people in our country. Access to coverage and to behavioral health treatment and services are now at parity with other health care needs, and hopefully future generations will never consider it otherwise. Think about that. A generation of young people who won't even know what it means not to have behavioral health services as part of their coverage. Young people, as you've heard today, are talking about mental health. They are becoming familiar with the once unfamiliar. They're thinking about and understanding behavioral health in the context of and not separate from their health. Because behavioral health is essential to health. So two final things. First, I want to ask you to mark your calendars next year on May 7th, 2015, because we're going to celebrate the 10th anniversary of SAMHSA's National Children's Mental Health Awareness Day, and we want you to be a part of it. We'll be engaging our collaborating organizations and our federal grantees very soon in preparation for this milestone event. And second, I hope many of you will stick around for the 4 o'clock p.m. today, a session in room Woodrow Wilson A for a workshop titled What Youth Really Need, where you can hear even more about what Jim, Quayle, Sean, and Michelle are looking to their peers to help them navigate. So thank you very much, and have a great afternoon.